As far as countries go, the Principality of Monaco is tiny. With a territory of only 2 square kilometers, it is one of the world's smallest states, second only to Vatican City. And while Monaco can easily fill a busy itinerary, this means that most attractions stand close to each other so you can easily explore on foot. You can travel independently or join a guided walking tour. Hey there, poor traveler! We are Vince and Josh. Whether you're pulling a DIY or joining a group tour, here are some of the key places to visit and things to do in Monaco. Before we begin, don't forget to subscribe to our channel and ring the bell to get notified when we upload new travel videos. This is possibly the most famous of all the attractions in Monaco. It was opened in 1863 to save the House of Grimaldi from going bankrupt after losing significant chunks of its territory. After a pretty rocky start, it became the primary source of income for the state and the royal family. It also turned out to be extremely profitable that the state absolved its citizens of all taxes. Today, Monegasque citizens still are not obligated to file income taxes, which is why wealthy families move here. Even if you don't play, visitors may enter the building and take photos in the atrium or lobby area for free. The building also houses the Opera de Monte Carlo and the headquarters of Le Ballet de Monte Carlo. It's open for visitors and tourists daily from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. As you can see, it's a pretty small window, so make sure you mind your timings when making your itinerary. Casual attire is allowed at the atrium and the Salle Renaissance in the daytime only. Bermuda shorts, jeans, t-shirts, and sports shoes are okay. But sportswear, tank tops, faded jeans, jeans with holes, beach shorts, jogging shoes, and flip-flops are not allowed. Beyond the atrium and the Renaissance room, a stricter dress code is observed, especially at night. Also known as the Port of Monaco, Port Hercules is the only deep-water port in the Principality. Located in the La Condamine district, it takes up much of the state's coastline. The harbor has been used for centuries as a major port, but its modern era began in 1926. It can shelter up to 700 boats and yachts. The port is surrounded by luxurious restaurants and bars and offices of sporting organizations like the Yacht Club of Monaco and the Monaco Rowing Club. You can also find in the area the Esplanade, Carousel Monte Carlo, and an Olympic-sized saltwater swimming pool. It is also quite possibly the most photographed view in Monaco. While it's great to walk around the area, it's best viewed from the Prince's Palace grounds. Although freedom of worship is guaranteed in Monaco, Roman Catholicism is the official religion of the state and is practiced by the biggest chunk of the population. Aside from smaller chapels, Monaco has one cathedral and 5 parish churches, including Saint-Devot Chapel, dedicated to the state's patron saint. Tucked under Larvotto Boulevard, this small chapel isn't very striking at first glance, but what it lacks in size, it makes up for in its history, which can be traced as far back as 1070. It has undergone several restorations and rebuilding over centuries. Monegasque tradition also dictates that the Princess Bride must lay her bouquet here after the wedding. In front of the chapel is a sharp bend, which is the first turn on the Monaco Grand Prix circuit. Le Marché de la Condamine is one of the 2 main marketplaces in Monaco. The other one is Monte Carlo Market. Established in 1880, La Condamine Market currently has 2 main sections, the open-air area at Place d'Armes and a covered hall. The open-air section is where you'll find local traders selling flowers, fruits, vegetables, and other fresh produce. Inside the halls, you'll find bread and fish among others. The best part for tourists? A relatively budget-friendly food court where you can grab quick lunch. Create your paso dish at Maison de Pat or sample a soca from Chez Roger. It's bursting with tasty options, so make the rounds first before queuing. When you have your meal on hand, find an empty seat at one of the shared tables. Now you've reached Le Rocher, the Rock of Monaco, a 62-meter monolith where you'll find Monacoville, the oldest part of the city. Perched on top of it is the Prince's Palace, which is the official residence of the Prince of Monaco. If the Rock of Monaco is a giant cake, this is the cherry on top. It was initially a Genoese fortress constructed in 1191. Throughout the course of its history, many foreign invaders have tried to invade it. The Grimaldis, A family from Genoa in modern-day Italy successfully infiltrated and conquered it in the late 1290s. Since then, it became their seat of power for over 7 centuries up to now. Today, the Prince of Monaco still calls the palace home. One of the most popular activities here is watching the changing of the guards, which happens every 11:55 a.m. daily. This traditional ritual has not changed in over a century. The palace grounds also offer the best view of Port Hercules. Entrance fee is 10 euro. If you also plan to enter the Oceanographic Museum, you might want to purchase a combination ticket which costs only 23 euro. The Monaco Cathedral is more formally known as the Cathedral of Our Lady Immaculate. Completed in 1903, it is sometimes called St. Nicholas Cathedral, which is the name of the country's first parish church that used to stand at the same site. Inside, you'll find the beautiful Carrara marble episcopal throne and the great altar. It is also the final resting place for many members of the royal family, including Princess Grace Kelly and Prince Rainier III. Just next to the cathedral is a smaller but equally captivating building, the courthouse. Called Palais de Justice, it was constructed in 1924 out of sea tuff to match the Genoese fortress surrounding the city on the rock. Visits or tours are not allowed, so tourists can't enter. But you can take a photo of it from across the street. St. Martin Garden is a relaxing space in between the cathedral and the Oceanographic Museum. Opened in 1816, this was Monaco's first public garden. It used to be adorned only by Mediterranean trees, but exotic flora were later on planted. Aside from its Aleppo pine trees, this garden on the Rock of Monaco has short walking trails and a statue of Prince Albert I. From the St. Martin Garden, you can have a great view of Fontvieille, the principality's youngest district. Due to its not-so-spacious territory, Monaco has land shortage problems. One of the solutions made is to reclaim land from the sea and build another ward on it. That's Fontvieille. You can also visit Fontvieille if you have more time, but this itinerary is already pretty packed, so you can just admire it from a distance. Called Musée Océanographique de Monaco in French, it is a marine science museum housed in a beautiful Baroque Revival building. It showcases over 6,000 specimens within 6,500 square meters. The museum was founded in 1910 by Prince Albert I, who led numerous scientific expeditions and dedicated much of his life to exploration and oceanography. He was the great-great-grandfather of the current monarch, Prince Albert II. Walking tours usually just stay outside, but you can go inside after the tour if you wish. Situated in the easternmost ward, La Roboto Beach is fronted by several luxurious hotels and restaurants. While it is a gorgeous beach, it tends to be crowded, especially at peak hours. Monaco has only 4 kilometers of coastline, and this is the best part of it, so beach lovers tend to flock here. This beach is strewn with tiny shingles, not fine sand. It has private and public areas. You can easily tell them apart because private beaches usually have a restaurant and rows of beach chairs. If you want to get comfortable, you can rent a chair for at least 30 euro per day. Steep, I know, but everything is pricey here. Even bottled water costs a lot. If you're on a budget, you can chill at a public beach. Bring your own towel or mat to sit on, but it may be difficult to find a spot in peak season, which is why you should try to arrive early. If you're a football fan, you're gonna love this place. The Champions Promenade is a walkway around the Grimaldi Forum that features some of the biggest names in the footballing world. Think of it as Monaco's answer to the Hollywood Walk of Fame, but instead of movie stars, it honors the recipients of the Golden Foot Award, which is an international recognition to an outstanding active player every year. Also, instead of handprints, the winner leaves footprints. A piece of Japan in Monaco. This seaside park is situated next to Grimaldi Forum, along the Avenue Princess Grace, and is surrounded by towering buildings. Designed by Yasuo Beppu, this Zen park boasts a tea house overlooking a pond, a Zen garden, and a bridge among others. It's a relaxing oasis in the middle of the buzzing La Roboto ward. Any travel article about this corner of Europe won't be complete without a mention of the Monaco Grand Prix, the most prestigious Formula One race in the world. On two weekends of May every year, everything else in the principality seems to be at a halt as the focus shifts to the race. With its hilly terrain, narrow roads, and tight turns, Monaco Circuit is also widely regarded as one of the most challenging, if not the most challenging. As you explore Monaco, you'll be seeing and crossing some of the circuit sections. But the most recognizable part of the Monaco Circuit is this one. This is one of the most difficult points of the circuit. Because of the narrow road and sharp turn, it is virtually impossible for two cars to negotiate this side by side at race speed, which is why it's also the slowest part of the track. It's currently called Grand Hotel Herpin. I say currently because its name changes when the hotel in front of it changes names, which has happened numerous times. If you need more information about traveling around Monaco or Europe in general, you'll find comprehensive travel guides with sample itineraries on our website, www.theportraveler.net, or check out the links in the description. If you have questions, sound off in the comment section below. You can also follow us on Instagram, TikTok, Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube. Just look for @ThePoorTraveler. You may also tune in to The Poor Traveler podcast on Spotify or Apple Podcasts. That's all for now. Remember, plan smart, travel safe, and make every trip worth it.